Hey there, so in case you haven't heard, Mark Waid is being sued by Diversity in Comics regarding tortious interference with his contract with Antarctic Press and the distribution of Jawbreakers. Now, within that, I don't want to focus on everything there. What I want to focus on are statements like this. In fact, I'm going to focus on this specific statement and the two people inside of it. So let's look at the statement first. Chris Ryle says, "Hey, Mark Waid, if you need a character witness, please feel free to contact me or the entirety of the legitimate comic book industry." Now, with legitimate comic book industry, I find that word to be very telling about the mindset that this person has. You know, it's that stuck-up narcissism of we are the gatekeeper. We are comic books. People out there that are making independent comics, yeah, you folks, you don't count. Very interesting to see that. Now, if we're talking about the legitimate comic book industry, this guy is very telling, too, because until recently, he was in charge of IDW as their editor-in-chief. I say until recently because he had put in over a decade in charge, and around 2014, things, they started declining and declining until 2017, the wheels fell off. And then this year, wow, what a firestorm. Effectively, you're talking about a company that, as of right now, they are $7 million in the hole. I mean, revenue minus expenses equals, well, they're at negative $7 million. They've taken around $20 million in debt for a $50 million equity. So, I mean, we're talking about a company that is in dire disarray. And there's so much more there. This guy, he was let go because of it. He can say that he left, but yeah, you know, if you force a guy to walk the plank, well, he may walk right out into the ocean voluntarily and, you know, feed himself but the sharks, but really, was he doing that without being pressured to do so? You know, we also saw the co-founder go, the president go. We saw so many people taken out there, and while he's doing so, irreparable damage was done to the comic book portion, to the point that we're talking about around $2.5 million so far in revenue declines. They've cut expenses, including artist payment, by about $886,000, and we saw another almost 100,000 cut off salaries. So you're talking about quite a bit of money that directly impacts the people that are out there that perform these functions. That happened under this guy's watch. Now, why does that happen? Well, if we look at some of the controversies out there, we can see how it happens under this guy's watch because of the way that he looks at comic book consumers. There was this broadcast here that talked about those terrible, pesky comic book consumers. You know, the people like you and I that want professionalism and good products. This guy, he decided he would go with the buzzwords. And he said, "Oh, thanks for the nice words. And if you're right that I managed to piss off Transformer readers who are anti-LGBTQIA, anti-trans and anti-progress, then that makes me happy too." So when you look at that statement there, you know, he admits that people are readers. That means that they're buying your books. And yet, you know, when you find out the editor-in-chief really doesn't have anything for you there, yeah, you kind of find yourself walking away. And the numbers, they indicate that people have been walking away. And when they do, yeah, it's going to be really, really difficult to get them back. Now, another thing that happened under his watch happened with Aubrey Sitterson, and we're just doing really, really broad strokes here. So, Aubrey Sitterson said this to start it out. He said, "Oh, good, it's the self-centered national tragedy remembrance for people who weren't even anywhere near New York City Day, September 11th, 2017. Now, this, it became a firestorm of controversy, because instead of backing down, this guy went at it again. Again and again, and he had already gone out and antagonized G.I. Joe readership so many times. There are many of articles out there that you can look up on that. Now you find out that the reason that nothing transpired, the reason that this guy wasn't removed at first, was because of him, because of Ryle. He said in an interview, after he was walked the plank, necessarily, he said, "The story has gotten spun in such a way that it makes us look like the bad guys, and it kills me that that's the case." Now, right here, when you first start reading it, you think, hey, this guy's talking about, hey, I'm not the bad guy with readers. But no, let's continue here, because that's all came about because somebody said things that companies that that I don't own took exception to. But I and a couple of others really staked our jobs on not making rash decision of having that person removed and keeping the book going and even rewarding that person with a new series. So, they're talking about blowback from the other side there. You know, not readership. They're talking about pros out there that didn't like the idea that they might actually be beholden to some rules. Oh man, isn't that fun? They even rewarded that guy that said this kind of stuff about people. They rewarded him with a new series. But let's continue. Ultimately, that new series didn't sell. I'm sure there are all kinds of ideas of why it didn't sell, but the fact is, it didn't sell right from the start, and so it had to go away. Yeah, it was canceled before it ever came out. But somehow rewarding somebody with a new book and not giving in to these idiots who were trying to put pressure on things got spun to being that we didn't support this person. So you like the word there. These idiots. Not giving in to these idiots. That's how they saw consumers at the time. Isn't that lovely? You know, because just like he called Transformer readership bigoted, idiots too. That, I think, is the thing that hurts. Because we did. We supported him, kept his job, gave him a new book, and it killed me that it didn't work. Also, at times, I was going to go out there and try to defend it, trying to say, no, you're wrong, and keeping the conversation going and giving a forum for people to say more terrible things just felt like a losing battle. My entire time at IDW, I always approached things as the air is much fresher on that high road. So we thought that calling consumers idiots, thinking of them that way, giving a guy that went out and continually insulted his consumer base, that was taking the high road. Very telling for why he doesn't have a job now. But again, that is the guy who thinks that he is the representative of the legitimate comic book industry. He is also now encamped with Skybound. You know, if we're talking about another Image title now, we're talking about yet another guy that's encamped there after we've heard so many terrible things coming out of yet another company. So there is yet another one. We have IDW, and now we have Image. This guy is one of their editors there, and yeah, of course, you see exactly what he thinks about you. Good fun there, don't you think? Lots and lots of fun. Now, the other name in that, of course, Mark Waid. He has a very, very colorful past. I mean, here we're talking about, for example, an interview about his time with CrossGen. Now here we have the owner of CrossGen talking about him as a psychopathic megalomaniac, in my opinion. Did anyone ever tell you about the fit he threw in the building? We had to ban him from coming into CrossGen. Do tell. 60 witnesses. He got into a pissy fit, which was more the norm than not. Went into his office, punched 4 or 5 holes in the wall. How could he miss all the studs? Broke all his little toys all over his office from DC and Marvel and stormed out of the building. We left the office that way for months and months and months to remind people that this is not tolerated. He had to meet his ruse team off-site. They were really writing the story. Mark was showing up periodically to offer his assistance. So 60 people afterwards, this is after the thing closed, he had sent them a black wreath. So 60 people, purportedly his friends, had just lost their income streams, and he sent them a black wreath. It said, "What would your wife, Jill, think about you now? My wife, who died 2 years earlier from a heart attack." Man, what a great, great guy there. You know what's terrible about that, too, is I saw John Layman actually celebrating this, like this was something to applaud. I saw him make a comment talking about how Mark Waid, he was such an entertaining guy. Isn't that freaking lovely? I mean, Mark Waid, well, this isn't the first time that you've had stories about him out there. This is, in fact, one of my favorites, and I apologize for the blurriness. I'm going to blow it up just a little bit, but just listen to it. And really, when I'm reading it off, really imagine this scenario. It will end pretty quickly there, but just really imagine the way that this sets up. So, Groth here. I didn't pay much attention to Waid's work habits or to Amazing Heroes. He seemed like he did his job. But one day, I got into the office earlier than I usually did, maybe at 9 or 10, because I probably didn't go to sleep the night before. So, I'm in the office, which was off the quote-unquote living room area of the house where Wade and other people had desks. I couldn't see a sliver of the area from where I sat. Tom and I shared the space, which was long and rectangular, and in my line of sight there, it was limited. So I'm in my office, and suddenly I hear a crash, followed by screaming and sobbing. It sounds like someone was being thrashed or mutilated. So I ran out of the living room, and I see Wade on the floor, banging a phone receiver on the ground over and over again, and weeping and screaming. I look around me, and absolutely no one is paying attention to this. Joe and Bob are huddled over their typewriters. Dave is sitting calmly at his desk. It's as if I'm the only one who's witnessing this mess. I thought maybe I was hallucinating. So I scream at Wade, "What the F are you doing?" And he looks up, startled, composes himself, picks his phone up, puts it on his desk, and sits down. No one says a word. Wade's behavior was unnerving enough, but even more unnerving was everyone else's lack of a reaction. Later, when Wade had gone to lunch or something, I asked everyone, "What the hell was that about? Why were you all sitting around as if nothing was happening?" They basically told me that went on all the time, but only in the morning before I showed up. So they'd all gotten used to it. Now, can you imagine that scenario there? It's not only Wade going out and throwing a temper tantrum where he slams a phone up and down, but also where people, they grow accustomed to that to the point that they ignore it, because that is Mark Wade. Not the stories and not the cultivated image that you saw before. No, the true persona of the guy that is a quote-unquote professional and a quote-unquote talent. This is him, the guy who punches holes in walls, the guys who throws things around like this. And also, I mean, within that, the guy who likes to threaten people because they take up too much table space. So here's a comment here. We're just going to say Arthur S., you know, to make this easier here. "My biggest regret this weekend is not being at this Comic-Con here to personally and forcibly move Arthur S. shit off of other artists' tables." Fun guy. You know, and then somebody said, "At least you know, Mark, you'll probably have the opportunity at a show in the future." He says in return, "I long for it. All I can see when I close my eyes is me literally turning over tables." Yeah, he sounds like a great guy, doesn't he? Then just checked. You know, S there is at an island to himself at Tampa, and my next post-SDCC show. He can't pull shit there, and he will be watched. Trust me. I mean, does that sound like somebody that's going to be, you know, in their right mind and doesn't threaten other people? Then he continues here, "Busy contacting every show I'm doing for the rest of the year to warn them that if Arthur S. pulls this shit there, I'll make it loud and ugly." I mean, can you imagine that, too? You know, anyone want to help me compile a list of upcoming cons the guy will be at? I'll make every effort to curb his shit. Trust me. So, I mean, you see this threat there. That's why I always say, you know, when you look at him and you look at the way that he interacted with diversity in comics, and I'm not trying to include diversity in comics into this conversation, but if you look at the way that he was included in this and the way that he treated Antarctic Press, of course, this guy is not stable. That's why I talked about the Baltimore Comic Con. Can you imagine, for example, this quote here, and imagine the person that said that, you know, that said these other things. For anyone attending this week's excellent Baltimore Comic Con, I have an important request. There is a serial YouTube harasser named Richard C. Meyer, who I'm told will be attending as a fan. If anyone sees this gentleman or any of his friends, I need you to come find me and tell me immediately. Even if I'm on a panel, come and interrupt. Please circulate this request as widely as you possibly can through all of your social media accounts. Fellow pros, tell each other. This is about attempting to lessen the harassment of women in comics, and it is important. Please spread the word. Thank you. Does that seem like something that wouldn't end in violence? I mean, he said things like this in the past. I mean, if he talks to the wrong person, you know, this goes very, very badly if I talk to the wrong guy. So, yeah, I mean, again, does this sound like someone that would not go in and threaten when of course I take everything that he said there as a threat. And we're talking about small business there too. You know, since the legitimate comic book industry out there, well, apparently small business, does that fit in? I mean, apparently you would think so, but for these guys, I don't really think it does. I mean, if you look at Antarctic Press and all of the things that involve them, we'll go further. Look at how Alterno was treated. I mean, in this lengthy diatribe, which I have a video about, we have Mark Waid talking about fans, and we have him talking about Alterna. In here, he talks about how following creators, I mean, if you go to a certain portion here, you following a creator, yeah, that's a privilege to begin with. It's not a God-given right, and getting blockbotted, it's not a personal attack, because of course, that was a privilege. You know, getting to listen to someone's diatribe about that, you know, that was a privilege and not your God-given right. He rambles and rants about this because Alterna, they had the audacity to call out people's bad behavior in having a social media policy that said you can't block indiscriminately, but individually, and also within this, thinking consumers. Now, again, that doesn't even touch on the Antarctic Press stuff. It doesn't even go into all of that because there is plenty of detailing with it. It just showcases two people out there that think, number one, that this guy is a good representative of what comics should be, and the other guy, he's going to be a character witness for, of course, the legitimate comic book community out there or the comic book industry. If that's legitimate, well, I'm glad that I am not supporting that anymore. But you tell me what you think about this. My final thoughts on this, wow. I mean, when you see this reflection, you can't unsee it. And when you see them going out again and again and bullying and harassing comic book companies, you can't unsee that either. It's something when you finally catch a glimpse of it, it's bothersome. I hope that Diversity in Comics truly brings out all of the things about this guy so people see him once and for all, not for the cultivated image that created comic books, you know, back when, but rather for the truly petty and vindictive person that this guy is. Now, if you like this kind of content, please consider supporting the channel. You know, this is Wrong Think, obviously. We cover a lot of it, and well, it's something that is de-incentivized under YouTube. There are two descriptions within the description there. There is a PayPal link, and there is also another link for Patreon. All of that, of course, it goes to the betterment of channel. There are other channels out there that cover things too, so make sure you support them. But within this, make sure you tell me what you think about it too, because this stuff, it is insane. Tell me what you think about this guy and the legitimate comic book industry. Tell me what you think that is. What does that mean? And is this something, do you think, that it's supported or not? Can you put your money into it knowing exactly what it looks like? Anyhow, as always, thank you.